Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Laz. I've not forgotten about you guys. Doing a little live here. It's going to be a little bit about everything. Important things. We're going to be doing, I already put the IP addresses on this interface and on the actual PCs. I didn't do nothing on the switches. I didn't do anything on the router besides just that IP address. And I put the IP address on the server. What we're going to be doing in this particular lab, which you should try and practice at home, is we are going to go ahead and play around with Spanning Tree. We are going to do switch port security, all right? We are going to do VLANs. We're going to do inter-VLANs, and then we're going to do NAT, all right? And then we're going to go across, all right, and see if NAT is working, and if it's not, why is it not working, okay? So we're going to give that a shot, all right? So let's go ahead and get started. All right, first let's verify. So you see, well, you can see the networks. Here's the 20 network. Here's the 30 network, okay? So that means when we do create our VLANs, that'll be VLAN 30 over here and VLAN 20 over here. But again, we need to first choose our root bridge. And it just so happens that this is our root bridge. How do I know that? We need to know these commands, all right? Let's go to the CLI. Let's open this up a little bit here so you can see that. Let me bring it over here. Okay. Turn my keyboard around and do a show spanning. No, that's PAL. Oh, I'm in user mode. Ha ha ha. Enable. Show spanning. All right. Try to abbreviate too much. Okay. My eyes deceive me. Show spanning. Oh, SAP. My God, I can't type. Here we go. Show spanning tree. Okay. And it tells you right here. This is the root bridge. Let me highlight that. This is the root bridge. Okay. That's how you know it's the root bridge. Remember the election process. It will try to use first the priority number, but all switches have the same priority number by default. So then it goes down to the MAC addresses, all right? This information down here, this particular section, remember, it's about the switch. So here the MAC address is gonna be the same, but it's choosing the lowest MAC address in order to be the root bridge. And let's see if that's true. And here we got 00A. Try to remember this as best as possible. Okay. This one we know is not the root bridge because we have an orange. Okay. We have an orange port, which means that it's blocked. Okay. And you know what? I'm going to come over here to my laptop and I'm going to type it there. Enable. And I'll get out your way. Don't worry. Show spanning tree. Okay. And then we can see that the other one was 00A, this one's 009. So this is a higher MAC address, and you can see that port 21 right here is the one that is blocked. Port 22 is root. Anything facing the root bridge is a root port, period. Or the lowest cost to the root bridge is a root port also, could be, or designated, depending on where, how the design is, all right? And everything else is a designated port. Now, alternating block means just that. It's gonna listen for BPDUs, bridge protocol data units, but it will not forward anything out of its ports, all right? That's what spanning tree does. All right, so let's minimize that. So this is 009, all right? And then we'll get on this one. We'll get on this one. All right. And then let's open this bad boy up. Let me put it over here so I can get out of your way. And you can see it right away. Let's click on the CLI. Let's do enable. Show spanning tree. Enter. Okay. I'm going to bring it back over here. All right. And you can see that this is 005. The other one is 009. So the one with the block port is the highest MAC address. That's why it chose that to be blocked. And it chose a lower port number. I have always told you that a higher port number gets blocked because the bandwidth is the same. This is fast Ethernet. But because this port is facing the root bridge, it has to be a root port. Period. End of discussion. Okay? Since this is not facing the root bridge and it has the highest MAC address, therefore it chose that port to be blocked. This is how you need to think about it. Okay? And then since these two ports or this port is facing the root bridge, root port, right? We have it open somewhere. We'll just click on it again. There it is. So we have two designated forwarding ports, which will forward information. And then we have port 23, which is that one you can see is sneaking right there. Let's move this out this way. All right, it's going up to the root bridge. Therefore, that is a root port, okay? But enough about that. Now, if you do, let's see if this packet tracer, let me get on this side. I'll put this over here so you guys can see. Put it up high. There we go. Show spanning tree. Let's see if it has summary on there, if I spell it correctly. Yes, it does. How about that? Let's maximize the screen then, because this is going to be kind of hard to see. And we're running right here. If you can see this, we're running in PVST. PVST. Now I'm going to see if the packet tracer supports in changing it to rapid spanning tree. All right. I'm now doing everything in viral, which is, so I kind of forgot some of the stuff. Config T in the packet tracer. See if it supports it. Conf T. Spanning tree. Mode. Let's do a question mark. And it really doesn't have it. You see? Oh, yes, it does. Rapid PVST. Okay, let me get out of the way. Let me put it over here. Let me restore it. All right. So what I did was I did a summary. All right. And I saw that we were running in PVST mode. All right. You want to run in rapid PVST mode. Okay. Hey, where'd it go? There you go. You want to make sure you're running in rapid PVST. Why? Because you can create an instance per VLAN and the convergence is going to be a lot quicker. So what we did was, all right, we changed the mode of spanning tree to rapid PVST. Rapid. Now, the good thing about rapid PVST, not only can you create your own instance and it's a faster convergence, but it's backward compatible. Is backward compatible. But let's go ahead and do it to all the switches. So we already did it to that one. So let's minimize that one. Let's go to the root bridge. Okay. Bring it over here so you can see what I'm doing. Hit enter a couple times. And we'll do global config, config T. We'll do spanning tree, mode, rapid PVST, enter, do WR. Is this something you're going to see in your CCNA? They may ask you questions about it. They may ask you questions about it. Okay? But now you know. All right? And we'll do the last switch. Let's bring this down. All right? Let's bring this guy up. Bring him over here. All right? So we're going to do config T. Rapid. Not rapid. Spanning tree. SAP, spanning tree, rapid, try to vibrate, spanning tree mode, how about that one, lads? Rapid, thank you. All right, I think it did it for me. I don't think I even typed DR. All right, rapid spanning tree. Now, all the switches are in the latest rapid PVST, okay? That's how you do it. And again, backwards compatible, so conversion should be a lot quicker, all right? And let's minimize this and see if we see any changes that took effect. As you can see, it's still doing an election. Since we did do a change to spanning tree, we'll see which one of these ports turns to forwarding, which one will stay blocked. You see, everything stayed the same. If we were to open this switch and we were to do a show, or well, let's go to privilege mode. And do a show. Spanning tree, you see that this is still the Rue Bridge. So the election process still stays the same. It's a convergence that's going to be different. Now, we need to create our VLANs. Now that we've messed around with spanning tree, okay, we're going to create our VLANs, all right? And we're going to lower the priority after we do so, all right? So I'm going to minimize this. And remember, we have VLAN 20, we have VLAN 30, but we also have the default native VLAN, which is 1. So we're going to go ahead, and I do everything from the root bridge, okay? I do everything from the root bridge, okay? So let's go ahead first and create our two VLANs, which is 20 and 30. And you've seen me do this before, so this should be nothing new, maybe for some people, but not for others. Well, let's give this switch a name so we know where we're at. So config T, we'll call this root. We'll call this root, host name root. I called it Rue. Okay. Root. Okay. There we go. Host name root. Okay. So let's lower the priority. Let's lower the priority. Spanning tree. VLAN 1, because it exists, comma 20, comma 30. All right, that's how you lower the priority numbers. Oh, I forgot a command, excuse me. Should have gave me incomplete. Priority, and I didn't maybe because we're running span tree. Priority 0. Okay, that's the complete command. But you see, I think it would have, and this is an assumption, if it had been in regular PVST, it would have given me an error or an incomplete command, which it didn't, because we can run an instance per instance of span tree. So span tree VLANs 1, 20, and 30 are not running the same instance and priority 0, because for CCNA, and I've said this a million times, the way you do things in the CCNA are completely different than how you do it in the CCNP, and are completely different when you do it on the CCIE. Okay? I'm telling you this now. The commands change. Period. All right? They change completely. All right? You didn't even know that they existed. All right? Because not even in the books, they're there. Okay? Anyway. So we lower the priority, so we make sure that this particular bridge or switch is it's going to be the root bridge for all these VLANs. All right, now let's create the VLANs. So VLAN 20, we'll leave VLAN 1 alone, that's the native VLAN. VLAN 20, name, obviously we'll call it faculty, you know that. And then VLAN 30. Name students, right? So let's check that out. Let's see if that took. Let's do a WR, which in your exam, the CCNA, those are either 10 CNA, you can't do a WR, you gotta do a copy run start. We'll do a show VLAN, and we see that we have faculty right here and we have students right here, but you see that we have no ports assigned to these two VLANs, and we will not have any ports assigned to those VLANs on the root bridge. We're just creating them. The goal is for those to come down to the client switches. What do you mean, Laz? Client switches. Let me show you. Show VTP mode. Oh, status. Sorry. Show VTP status. If I type VTP, show VTP stat. Okay, as you can see, all switches are servers by default. They send and receive information. Okay, so we're going to have one server, recommendation, one server, and the rest of the switches are clients, and the rest of the switches are clients. Okay, so what we're going to do is, this is going to set a server, and this one's going to send everything down. But in order for that to happen, we need to create a VTP domain name, which right now is null. Is nothing. There's nothing there. So we're going to do global config VTP domain Lies. Okay, and we do an up arrow. All right, doesn't want to do it. All goes in privilege. That's why. Show VTP stat. All right, now you can see the domain name is last. So we created our VLANs. We lowered the priority. We created our VLANs. We did a domain name. So now all these switches are going to be part of this domain name, security purposes, right? You bring in a switch from somewhere else, it's not part of the domain, it's not going to receive the information. It's not going to receive the information. That's one of the reasons why you want to do that. And to be quite honest with you, you want to also do a password for the domain. We're not going to do it here because it's a lab. But in the real world, you would put a password for your domain. That way they can't get into it. All right? Or they can guess it and say, oh, I know what it is. All right, so now what we need to do is trunk the ports, okay? Trunk the ports. And you see these ports here need to be trunked, these three. These two need to be trunked, okay? Because VLANs are going to go, VLANs other than the native VLAN are going to go across those ports. Remember, from our studies in the CCNA, only VLAN 1, the native VLAN, the administrative VLAN, the management VLAN, whatever you want to call it, okay? That is the only one that can go through access ports and trunk ports. Every other VLAN must go through a trunk port, okay? So we must trunk these ports. If you trunk each and every port, you're going to create a loop. Remember that span tree is running and it's looking to block a port. So if you trunk this port, it'll turn green. Therefore, you create a loop. Don't do it. All right. So we're going to go ahead and trunk these ports right here. And it will dynamically trunk those ports right there. Okay. So let's get the root bridge out. Okay. And see, there's a reason for my madness. 23, right? 22, 23, 24. I can create a range. So config T. Can you see that? I'm going to bring this a little bit over here. Okay. We're going to do a range. Int range F0/22-24. Enter. You see, you're now in if range. So anything you do is going to affect those ports. All right. And we're going to do switch TCH, switch port mode trunk. Okay. And you can see that how they turn amber. You see how that's turning amber? All right. Now you're changing those ports from an access port to a trunk port. You're deliberately trunking those ports. And we'll wait for this one to finish. All right. It should be quicker than what it is, but hey, it'll turn eventually. But we can take a look at these ports right here. All right. Control Z. I'll do a do WR. Don't want to lose any of my configuration. And we'll do a show. Remember these commands. Show int trunk. Okay. You can see that ports 22 and 23, it's using the 802.1Q. All right, it's trunking. All right, why isn't it showing port 24? Because we haven't done nothing on the router. We haven't done anything on the router, therefore, it's off. That port is off. That's why you don't see it. All right, so 802.1Q encapsulation. That's the new encapsulation. So those ports are trunked. You can see that turned green already. So let's minimize this one. And let's open up the faculty switch. That one over there will be the faculty switch, okay? And the first thing that we're going to do, we're going to get a name so we know where we're at. And we said this was the faculty switch, so host name faculty, okay? Now we're going to turn the switch mode from server, because remember, all switches are server, we're going to change it to client mode, okay? So VTP mode, client, all right? Watch the magic. Do, show, VLAN. Aha! Faculty and students came down automatically, all on their own, okay? Let me do a control C here. Let me do a break. Show or do show. Do show. VTP. Stat. Okay. You can see that I am part of the... Hey, it doesn't like my finger. I mean, it's greasy. LAS domain. Okay. So that's why you want to do. It cuts your work in half. You create all your VLANs on your root bridge. You don't assign them. You create them. You create them, and then they come down. Okay? But these things must be in place. The domain name, all right? And the trunk ports. Let's take a look at the trunk ports. It's going to be interesting on that switch right there, the faculty switch. Do show int trunk. Okay? You see? Automatic. It automatically trunked those ports. I didn't do it. Okay, so they're, because remember, these ports are listening and they're gonna do what their neighbor port tells them to do. Okay, so hey, oh, you're trunked? Oh, I'm trunked too. Okay, so that's what's gonna happen, and that's what did happen, and that's why these came down. So we're good to go. We're good to go. So now what we need to do is we need to assign the VLANs to the proper interfaces. Now, the PCs, they're plugged to port 1. We'll use the first 15 ports for VLAN 20, right? No big deal. So we'll create a range right there. So int range F0/1 through 20. Not 20, that's too much. 15. Well, it's not that it's too much. And then we'll do a switch port mode. Access, switch port access, VLAN 20. All right, and you can see that turns amber. I don't know if you can see that, it's turning amber. All right, but let me explain something here. In some switches, you don't need to do this command right here. For you CCNA people taking your CCNA exam, okay? This thing is like disappearing on me. I'm getting too close to the screen. All right? You better type that command. If that's your question, that command needs to be typed first because all the ports are in dynamic auto by default. And to assign a VLAN to a port, it must be an access port. So what we did, we switched it to an access port, and then we assigned the VLAN. That's it. Simple as that. You're taking a certification exam. Once you get to the real world, and you get to your respective employers, and they have high-end switches with high-end iOSs, they're more intelligent, they don't need to know, then fine, okay? You'll get the book, you'll know, oh, okay. You'll figure it out at that point. If not, for your CCNA certification, that is the command, okay? So we assign the VLANs, let's verify that. I'm gonna do a control Z so we can have some space. Let me do a do WR, you will do a copy run start. Oh, I didn't have to do a do WR, just WR, okay. So show VLAN. All right, let me open this up. And you can see that faculty, right? 20, VLAN 20. And we have ports 1 through 15. They're assigned to VLAN 20. Let's move this a little bit over this way. Okay, VLAN 20, it closed it. VLAN 20, faculty, those are the ports they're assigned to it. Okay. Now, we're not done with the switch. So now we assign the VLANs. Outstanding. What do we want to do? Well, spanning tree. Spanning tree is somewhat, it's good and it's bad. Why is it bad? Because when we plug in our computers, we got to sit there and wait for Spantry to look at it to say, are we going to turn this into a forwarding port? Or is this, are we going to be reaching BPDUs? So it takes time before it goes into forwarding, right? It's first AMBER for a little bit, then it goes to forwarding. So in order to avoid that process, we want to turn spanning tree off. But careful here, you're going to get a warning. If you turn spanning tree off, you're going to get a warning saying, are you sure you want to do this? Maybe not everybody got the memo, and they may plug in something they shouldn't do. They shouldn't plug into it, like another switch or a hub or a concentrator, whatever. All right, so let's see what happens. So in that range, so again, let me, you can see that, right? Let me move it this way. Let me get close over here. Right here. Config T, int range F0/1-15. Spanning tree, port fast. Whoa! We got a huge thing. Hey, are you sure you want to disable this? Look what happens. If you do, you may cause a routing loop. And you're like, I am sure. I send a memo out to everybody. But you know, there's that one individual that never gets the memo. And they're going to go ahead and plug in something that they shouldn't. Or you're going to have that rebellious employee that's going to leave your company soon. And he wants to play around with the network. Okay? So you have to take precautions. Precautions for things not to happen. So what do? You do spanning tree, BPDU, guard, enable. All right, BPDU guard, enable. This command right here. All right, BPDU guard, enable. What does that do? That watches. It's a guard. It watches what's coming in. Hey, are there any bridge protocol data units coming my way? And if there is, it shuts down the port. Now, obviously, you'll be running some sort of third-party software that's going to tell you, hey, this port just got turned off. It's an error disabled state. You got to see, find out what's going on. You get a beeper, a phone call, smoke signals, whatever. Okay? You're going to get some sort of notification that that port came down or a lot of phone calls to the help desk, one or the other. All right? And then you find out, oh, somebody plugged something in. All right? That's what that's there for. Also, since we're talking about a little bit about security here or protecting our switch. Switch port security. Switch port, port hyphen security. This command down here enables port security. Okay? Sounds like a question to me. Switch port security enables port security, okay? You want to do that on your switch. What is it that you're going to do with switch port security? Okay, I'm going to up arrow, switch port security. I want to have my MAC address to be sticky. MAC sticky, what does that mean? Hey, I want you to learn the MAC addresses of every device that gets plugged into me, but I want it to be dynamically, right? But when you put it in the MAC address table or the CAM table, I want it to show as static. So it's sticking that MAC address to that port, right? That's what that's doing. It's going to automatically learn it, but it's going to show up as static that you put it in there. Nobody can take it out. Then, you say, okay, well, now that it's learning it dynamically, I don't have to do it manually. I'm going to put a maximum because I am a rough network administrator. I'm going to have only one MAC address that can go there. If somebody unplugs that cable and brings in their laptop because they want to play Call of Duty, and that's going to shut down the port. But how is it going to shut down the port? Well, you got to type a violation. And I'll put a question mark. So you can see the options. You can protect the network. You can restrict the network. You can shut down. Shut down. That's what is recalled. Or required, not recalled. Shut. So if somebody unplugs the cable. And then this is after all the MAC addresses have been learned. The CAM table is full of the MAC addresses. It has all these ones coming down. And then you unplug it and plug something else in, it's going to shut down that port. So you want to do your switch port security. Okay? And then that's it. Do WR. Now, if you want to verify, you can do a show switch port security. Show switch, I can spell it, switch, like that. Show, come on, Laz. No. Of course there is. I'm going to maximize the screen for a second. You may lose the vision of what I'm looking for. It shows, so shows port security. Oh, show port security. La, 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 la. Okay, show port security. Show, see, show port security. And you're going to see this. Hey, one MAC address, okay, is the maximum you can learn. Right now, it hasn't learned any. All right, so there's no security violations. And this is what's going to happen if it goes beyond the max. Okay, that's what's going to happen. Cool. You want to see that change? All right, let's see that change. Let's go. Oh, we don't have another PC. Let's bring another PC here real quick because we're not routing yet and we're in a different VLAN. So let's bring out another PC just so I can show you, all right, what would happen. All right, and I'm going to cheat. All right, I'm going to cheat. And let me see if I can move this a little bit this way. I'm going to use the mouse. It'll be a lot easier. Whoa. Oh, yeah, because I have that connection thing. All right, let me, oh no, silly me. Let me just move this way. And then I'll move just this right here. I'll bring it this way on this side so you can see what I'm doing. Okay, and then I'll put it back to somewhat of a normal fashion. All right, and then let me go ahead and plug in. Let me cheat like I said I was. All right, it's gonna go to F02. I'm gonna put the IP address, which is in the 20 network, not there, silly man, right here. All right, that's going to be 192.168.20.2.254. I'm going to put the gateway and everything in the same place, 192.168.20.254. That will be the gateway. All right, let's close that. Get the mouse again. All right, so now we can ping. Why did I close that? I don't know. We can ping 192.168.20.1. 20.2. Oh, I'm pinging myself. Okay, 20.1. All right, and we get a reply. La, la, la. This is beautiful. Now we should have in the switch. We should have in the switch, okay, right here. Let me go all the way to the bottom. Help me, help me. No, it doesn't want to help me. Let me go ahead and scroll down. Come on. Scroll down. There you go. Let's do an up arrow. Let's hit enter a couple times. Do an up arrow. Show port security, hit enter, and now it has two MAC addresses that it has learned on port 01 and 02. So eventually, when you start adding computers to that, this will get filled with the MAC addresses. That's it. It's reached the maximum. So if I try to do something else, a violation is going to come out. All right. So that's what switch port security does. It looks to see, and now that is the current MAC address on that one. You cannot go over that maximum. That is the maximum, or you will run into a violation. All right, that's that. So we assign the VLANs. We turn into a client. We assign the VLANs. We turned off span entry on where we're gonna put the end devices, and we did switch port security. We're gonna go ahead and do the same thing on the last switch. Let's go ahead and open that up, and let's leave it where it's at, because I don't want to be in your way. I can't help it if I'm getting bigger and bigger as I get older and older, right? That's just me. All right, so enable. This is the student switch, the student switch. Config T. So host name, student, just call it student. All right, we're gonna go int. Oh, no. VTP mode, client. We gotta verify, do you show VLAN? That those VLANs, they come down. They sure did. There's students, VLAN 30. There it is. Then we gotta assign VLAN 30, right? So we go int range F0/1 through 15. Switch port, TCH port. I have to say that, if not, I misspell it always. Switch port mode access, switch port access, VLAN, what? 30. That's right, you got it. While we're here, we'll verify later. All right, while we're here, let's turn off span tree since we're in the range and do the port security at the same time. So spanning tree, port fast, turn that off, get that big, don't do it, but we're gonna do it. We're gonna do spanning tree and we'll do a BPDU guard enable. We're gonna enable that guard on there to watch for BPDUs in case, to shut down the port to not cause any routing loops. And we do switch port, port hyphen security. We're gonna do up arrow. We'll do a max sticky, not sticky, sticky. Okay, we're gonna do a maximum of 1 because we're that kind of administrator. People don't like us. And then we're gonna violate. If you do a violation of it, you're gonna get shut down. All right, do WR, do WR. All right, so verification, show VLAN to see that actually those VLANs got assigned to the ports that we wanted to, and they sure did. VLAN 30, students, and there's the ports. Okay, we're gonna do show spanning tree, port security. And you can see our port security is there, but obviously he hasn't learned any MAC address. We will have to put another computer there so it can do the ARP back and forth, and that will go ahead and do that, and then the violation. So we're good to go there. We're good to go there with that. Now, and we're not gonna do anything with the root bridge, okay? We're actually gonna go into the router for the inter-VLAN connectivity. That means that we're gonna have to create sub-interfaces on this router. We're not gonna go ahead and do anything on the physical interface, but just turn it on. So enable, host config T, let's give this a name. Host name, I don't know, command center, command underscore, no spaces, center. All right, and then we're gonna go ahead and go into interface. Which one did I use? F00, that's the one I always use, right guys and gals? That's correct. Okay, so we're gonna go to interface, F0/0. We're gonna no shut it. We need to turn it on. We know that, or else what good is it? We're gonna no shut it is up, but we're not gonna put in an IP address. We're gonna put in now the sub interfaces. So we're gonna do a sub interface even for VLAN one in case we decide to start using it. All right, so we're gonna do int F0/0.1. All right, now, why did I do one? Why did I choose one? I can choose whatever number I feel like. I could put 100, I could put 99, I could put 80, 25. It doesn't matter. I put one because it's VLAN one. It's not required, but it's recommended visualization purposes. Why would you put something else that you wouldn't, you know, that doesn't match what you're doing? It's when you look at that sub interface, you know automatically, hey, this belongs to VLAN one. That's the whole point. Okay, you do what you want, but again, you try to make your job easy. Okay, then obviously we need to do the encapsulation, encap 802.1Q, right? That's what we're using, or .1Q, I'm sorry. .1Q, .1Q. And then this needs to match the VLAN that you're using, the VLAN ID that you're doing. So what are we doing? VLAN 1. So that's going to be 1. And then the IP address. So let's pick a willy-nilly IP address for VLAN 1. IP address, because we're really not using IP address in this lab, VLAN 1. So let's pick a class B. 172.16.1.1. Make it easy. 255.255.255.0. Wow. Okay. 255.255.255. Okay, my fingers. .0. Boom. So we got the IP address. All right. We got the sub interface. We got the encapsulation for that sub interface for the VLAN ID. And we got the IP address. This is initially the gateway for that particular IP, all right? Which usually I use 254, but since we're not using it, I put 1 just for whatever purpose. Now, we're going to create sub-interface. We got VLAN 20. So what do you think I'm going to use? 20. That's correct. Thank you for that response. Okay? Now, the NCAP is going to be 20. Required. Must match. What's the IP address? IP address. 192.168. Not, is it? No. Yeah. 168.20.254. 255. No. 255.255.0. Enter. Okay. That's done with that. Sub interface, NCAP, IP. Now we got the 30 VLAN. What do we do? Up arrow, up arrow, up arrow. Make life easy. What's up interface? 30. That's correct. What NCAP? It's got a match. 30. And then I'm just going to up arrow for the address so I don't keep making typos everywhere. And just change that 20 to a 30. Because that's the gateway for that particular one. So how do we verify? Let's do a control Z. WR. And I'm going to do a privilege mode, show IP int brief. Okay, you can see that everything is up. All right, let me move this way so you can see the other side of that. Up. Okay, and we have the sub interfaces with their 1.1s and the 20 with the 20.254, the 30.254. So we have all our VLANs assigned to what we need, okay? And this should be, why is this one down? Did I did the wrong interface? I don't know why is that going on there? I don't know. F01, I must have put an IP address there by mistake or something. Let me take that out. I don't want it to interface F01. Oh, that's a, yeah, okay. Let me take that out of there. I don't want that there. And, That's the IP address to the web server. That's right. Completely forgot. It's only 2 interfaces. All right. That's the IP address that we're going to use for NAT for the web server. That's why it's down, because the web server is not up. All right. Don't worry about it. Okay. So it's up, down. Let me bring it up a little bit more. Okay. It's up, down. 1.254. That should be up, really. Let's see why it's down, down. Let's move this a little bit. So we can move this way. Ah, who can tell me? Who can tell me? Anybody? Anybody who can tell me why it's down, down? What did Lass do that he shouldn't have done by mistake? It's a network plus, really, error. What cable am I using? I'm using a straight through cable. That's right. You in the back. You're good. That's right. It's a straight through cable. It has to be a crossover cable because PC to server is crossover. So let's change that cable. Let's see if we're right. Let's get the delete button. Before you hit delete, hit somewhere in the blank area here so you don't delete something that you don't want by mistake. All right, let's get rid of this cable. All right, let's go back to our selector tool. Get the right cable we need, which is a crossover cable. All right, and let me use this. Let's click on Fast Ethernet and Fast Ethernet 1. And that should turn green. Look at that, huh? When you do things the right way, it should say up, up, now. Oh, administratively down, I never turned it on. There you go, that's what that means. It still says up, down, even though it's up, up. So what you do is, in a situation like that, let's do it, well, that's the old show IP route. Let's look at the new show, not show IP route, show IP in brief. Show IP in brief. IP route, wanna look at the routing table. All right, there we go, everything's up, up now. Now we're good to go, straight. All right, we got the right cables, everything's good. Life is good. Let's see if we can ping across our VLANs. You will always, and this is holds true for CCNA and CCNP certifications. CCIE, all you're going to be doing is troubleshooting. All you're going to do is troubleshooting, all right, and verifying. But for the CCNA and CCNP, that you have those simulations that you have to do. Before you go to the next question, please, pretty please, make sure that if you have to ping, you have connectivity. Whatever it is, make sure you verify what you've done, either by pinging or by showing or whatever it is. But make sure you can get across your entire network. All right, so I'm going to go to, let's go to PC2. Why not? Okay, let's go ahead and ping the other network, 192.168.30.1. Right, that should be the PC. Let's see what happens. Now, it's Ethernet. We know we should miss the first ping, and then we get our replies. Right? Why do we miss the first ping? Because it's the ARP. If we do it again, we get replies all the way across. So we're good. We're good. We can get across. But how are the packets going? How are the packets going? The packets are not going like this, and they're not going. Definitely, they're not going like this because this port is blocked. They're going up to the router. The router's saying, hey, where do you want to go? I'm looking at my routing table. Oh, to this sub-interface. Send you out the sub-interface down to the switch to a correct place. That is what's going on, okay? So there's your lot of information right there, okay? VLANs, creating VLANs, assigning VLANs, changing the VTP mode of the switches to client, creating switch port security, turning off span entry. A lot of things. Now, the last thing we're going to do is NAT. And we're going to do dynamic NAT. Okay, so let's bring back the router. Okay, now we have to use that IP address on that interface because we really don't have a public IP address. So we'll do dynamic NAT. First thing you need to do on the interface that's going to the private side, that's your inside private address. The one on the other side, the F01, is the outside. All right, so config T. Config T, interface F0/now. This is the big question, ladies and gentlemen. Where do I put it? Do I put it on the physical interface or do I put it in the sub interface? In the sub interface. Because that's where the IP protocol is at. Okay? So for VLAN 20, F00.20. IP NAT inside. For 30, this up arrow. IP NAT inside. All right, done with that part. Do WR. All right, now we do the configuration of NAT. Remember, we're doing dynamic NAT, so we're creating a pool of addresses. So what do we do? IPNAT, pool, LAS, right? And we're gonna use a range, 1.1.1.254, right? Yeah, 1.1.1.1, no, 1.254, okay. Net mask. Let me move this way because we're going to run out of room over here. Net mask is going to be 255.255.255.0. Yes, it's a range of one IP address, right? We're doing dynamic NAT. It can hold up to 65,536 IP addresses to that one particular address. So this is how you do it. And I'm doing everything in lowercase. I'm doing it on purpose because I don't want to run into any case issues because there is case sensitive with the pool names. All right, so be very, very careful. Now, after I created my pool, I have to go ahead and create an access list, a standard access list that will permit these two networks to actually use the NAT. Okay. So, access list, tab that, access list, whatever, 10, permit, and we'll just do, let's just do two, 192.168, be specific about it, 20.0, okay, permit, yes, 20.0, 000, no, let's use no wildcard masking, forget that, let's use host, let's put host, let's use permit host, 192.168.20.0. I don't want to go ahead and start doing wildcard masking. It's not a big deal. It would have been just 000255, but the less typing down doing, the better. All right. And then 30.0. So now the access list is saying, hey, permit these two hosts. Deny everything else, right? Because there's no permit statement after that, right? Because these access lists are for a specific design, for a specific purpose. That is for them to listen to that interstream traffic that is the one going to use the NAT. And this third line is what's going to bring these two together. I'm going to space a little bit. All right, so you're going to do IP NAT, oops, IP NAT, not JP, IP NAT inside source list. Here, don't make a mistake. 10, that's the access list. Pool, what pool? Last, all lowercase, and the magical word overload. Okay, that's it. That is all there is to that. Let's do a control Z. Let's WR. Let's see if we can ping across. Now we're not running any routing protocols. We need to run routing protocols. Even though we're connected together, we shouldn't have to run routing protocol. Well, we're in different VLANs. So let's go ahead and just run config T. Let's do rip config T. Let's do a router rip, make it like it nice and simple. Version 2. Network class full addresses, ladies and gentlemen. 192.168.1.0. And not 1.0, 20.0. I have no idea why I did that. No net. 192.168.1.0. Okay, so get rid of that. No, net 192.168.20.0. Then we got 30.0. And what else are we attached to? We're not attaching anything else, are we? Not really. Well, we got the one right there, and then net 1.000. I mean, we shouldn't have the need really to do this, no auto summary, because we're connected directly to the router. There should be no reason why we should be configuring this routing protocol. I don't think it should hurt anything. So let's go ahead and see if from a PC, let's pick this time PC 0, okay? And let's move this way so you can see what we're doing. Desktop, CLI, no, not there. Command prompt, there you go. Ping 1.1.1.1, right? We should be able to ping across. Again, this is the first time we're pinging. So the first ping should be a request amount due to the fact of the ARP. There are replies. We're pinging fine. Let's ping again. Up arrow, enter. We guess you get 5 replies. Awesome. We're pinging. Let's see indeed if our NAT is working. Okay, so we're going to click on the router. Let's bring it up. Let's put it this way so everybody can see. How do you verify? Show IP NAT translation. I'm going to put trans for short. Translation. There we go. And it's not. It looks like it's not working. Why is it not working? What's going on? Why isn't it translating? Oh, I know. Because now we're going under the sub-interfaces, okay? And you're telling it to translate. You're telling it to permit, okay? You're telling it to permit these two networks, but guess what's happening? The only reason we're pinging across is because now it's not even taking place here. It's not even worried about it. It's not even seeing it. Why? Because when this IP address, when anything from the 20 or the 30 comes in, is being translated to the 1111. So once it gets translated, it's going to send it out anyway. So really, you wouldn't have to have your NAT. There'll be something here in between you, so that can actually help. The router, layer 3 switch, whatever the case may be. That's why there's a hierarchy. That's why there's a design for this. But I did this so you can see the configuration is correct for the NAT and for everything we've done so far. But since I put the NAT router right next to our LAN, that's not going to work. NAT's not going to work because NAT is telling it, hey, when you give me an address coming from 20 to 30, translate it to the 11111. Well, that's not happening. That's not even taking place here. So that is the reason that that is not happening. And we can verify. We can verify. Always verify. We can do a show start. I mean, it's very, very short configuration. Go one by one. All right. Fast Ethernet 00. We don't have to worry about it. Here we are. We have the native VLAN right here. Okay. With the 172.16.1.1, which we're not even using. Okay. We have, let's see, let's bring it up all the way over here. Okay. We have the sub 30 with the .q30, 30.254, 30.255. IPNAT inside, that's what you're looking for the IPNAT inside. And then the other IP address, which, there it is right here. We have the IPNAT inside as well. And then for the F01, oh, I did not put it. Maybe that's the reason that's not working. Huh? Interesting. Let's go ahead and see if we can fix that. Interface F0/1, IPNAT outside. Okay, do WR. Let's go ahead. Right, we did now. We went to F01, which is this interface right here. That is our IPNAT outside. Apparently, we have never put that before, or maybe we just didn't copy run start and it didn't show in the start. So let's try pinging again. I'm just going to up arrow. Try to get to that command, and apparently, I'm not going to get to that command. Okay, so I'm just going to ping my way across. Let's see what happens. Ping 1.1.1.1. And, oh, I'm sorry. I did it right through a router. Silly boy. Tricks are for kids. Let's pick another PC. All right. Let's move it to one side. Let's go to the desktop. Command prompt. Ping 1.1.1.1. That one. Now, reply. Got a reply. Beautiful. We have connectivity. We're connected to the same router, so we shouldn't really have any issues. Sometimes we don't really need that routing protocol there. All right. So, because you can see, I didn't put the 10 network or anything, nothing like that. That shouldn't be a part of this right here. Let's delete that out of here. Yes, I do want to delete that because this is a router on a stick. So I don't know why that was there. Okay. So let's go back to the NAT server. Whoops. Control Z. Let's bring that back. That's why I say you got to be very careful when you have to delete. You don't delete something you don't want. All right, so we're going to go, and I still have it. You see that X, right? All right, you got to be very careful. Click on that NAT router. Okay, let's put it over here. Let's go again to the CLI. Let's open it up a little bit so you can see better what's going on. All right, let's enable. Show IPNAT translations. It's not translating. It's not because I didn't do the show IP route. I mean, show IPNAT outside, or I didn't do the IPNAT inside, because I did. All right. It's the matter of how close is this to our actual LAN. That's why your NAT routers usually will be sitting close to your perimeters, your edge. All right. They're the ones who are doing the translations before it gets to the outside. That's why that is working the way it is. It's not going to do it because we're on the sub interfaces. That's why that's happening. All right. But there you go. Now you know. So be very careful when you are doing NAT. They won't do this for your certification. They'll probably ask you just questions on NAT. What's dynamic NAT? The differences between dynamic NAT and PAT or NAT overload, which is we just did. And that's another thing I want you to keep in mind when you're doing your CCNA, all right, is to actually show start. You want to take a look at your NAT configuration, okay? All right, you want to make sure that you have that word overload. If you're doing PAT or NAT overload, make sure you have that overload. You have the right IP address that they gave you, okay, with the correct mask. You're pointing to the proper access list, which we are. We're permitting those two networks to get to the outside, but they're not being translated because of that reason, because we're just too close to the NAT router itself. It's not doing the translation. It's not closing this window either, okay? That's why we have a mouse for, okay? So no big deal, no big deal. But you now know how to configure the NAT, all right? And you now know that if you are doing VLANs, you're doing a router on a stick, okay? That definitely that router on a stick, the one that's doing the intra VLANs, that will be your distribution layer, okay? You will not, you will run NAT on that one. You will not run NAT on that one. You will run it on the router above that. Okay, not on that particular router. Okay, that way it will do your translation because that means everything is being routed. Okay, here nothing's being routed. Everything's connected to the same broadcast domain. All right, enough said. I'm sure you've tired of hearing me talk. Whole bunch of information for your CCNA. Remember, you're taking a certification exam. Practice for the CCNA. Once you get to a real world, things may change. Commands may change. Hardware may change. But you know the basic concepts of it. Definitely, once you pass your CCNA or ICND1 or CCNT, whichever one you're taking, you go on to the CCMP. Believe me, that's a whole brand new world as well. You're going to see there's different commands there to do as well. I will see you in another lecture.